We are not professionals. And if anyone is here struggling with a few things, we recommend that you talk to a trusted adult, be that a teacher or a parent. And if not, you can always call Childline or the Samaritans. Equally, trigger warning, this is a mental health panel. We can't be 100% sure what we're going to talk about, but it could be anything from anxiety to quite heavy stuff like suicide and depression.
So my name is Scholar, and I'm a health and fitness type person. I make like workout videos and stuff. And I have not always struggled with mental health, but I remember having anxiety and like panic attacks around like the GCSE time when I was a bit younger. And then as I've grown up, it's just developed. I've gotten like anxiety and depression, and it's been off of the back of not just mental health, but like I have a thyroid condition, which sort of triggered everything, and that's when everything just went downhill, but it's been all right. So that's sort of my background and my mental health, so yeah.
My name's Luke, and I'm a mess. So I got my first proper diagnosis about a year ago, maybe a bit more. So I felt and sort of talked to people about having depression since I was about 15. Mixture of depression, anxiety, majority depression. And my diagnosis was for something called cyclothymia, which I don't know if anyone else knows what that is, but what cyclothymia is basically, if you don't know, is if you imagine bipolar is basically where you have manic highs, where you like think you can fly and want to buy loads of things, and you have deep lows where you feel very depressed, like deeply depressed. Cyclothymia is basically the same thing, but you don't have the manic highs. You just just feel rubbish. And then you feel okay. That's it. So it's without the highs, without the feeling you can fly. And I've spoken on mental health online for the entire time I've been on YouTube, I think. I've spoken with Childline on your channel as well, and with Tio. And I think in 1080 in your magazine. And yeah, it's just something I feel really passionately about, and I see my role as like people. I'm a person who apparently seems supposedly like I work, like I'm a working human being, and it's important to go, well, actually, not everyone, but you can look on the outside like this beautiful being you see before you, and still be a mess inside. Anyway, that's my intro.
Hi, I'm Marnie from Childline, and Luke's exactly right. I think everyone deals with lots of different things. So for me, like a lot of young people, I've felt stress and anxiety in my life, but I'm a trained counsellor, so I hear from all sorts of young people about all sorts of topics, like depression and self-harm and mental health in general as well. So I'm here to support them on those sorts of things.
So I've spoken about, the first thing I spoke about was self-harm. So I did a challenge called Cupcake, where for 7 days you would try and write out Cupcake one letter at a time, and that was part of a charitable thing I was doing with my friend Bri, which was Cupcake Not Wrists. I don't know quite how I feel about that term now, but at the time it helped a lot of people, and so that's the point, isn't it? Like, it might be a bit weird, but it helped people, so that's good. And then I've spoken about depression, and I plan to in the future talk about cyclothymia. Reason I haven't yet is because I don't really tell my parents about this because I don't want them to worry. So it's weird that I sort of tell a room of, I don't know, like 500 people or whatever, but I don't really talk to my parents about it because they have their own things in their lives that they have to deal with, and I know I'm all right, and I know that I can deal with it, and so I will talk about it, and I'll talk about it now, and yeah, and nothing's off limits. I just don't tell my parents about it because I don't want them to worry.
So when I first started getting like quite depressed, I was just worried and I didn't know what was going on. And I went straight to my sister, who's like my best friend ever. So she's usually the first person I'd tell if I'm struggling with anything. But I also actually went to tell my parents, which I was quite nervous to do, simply because I'm originally from Zimbabwe, and it's like quite bad that their mental health isn't really something people take seriously. They're just like, oh, just cheer up or something like that. But luckily my parents are quite progressive with that, so they were actually so helpful, and like they're always there if I need them and I can call them, and like they really helped me. Like in the mornings, if I just didn't want to wake up, they would like forced me out of bed and out of my PJs, which was really lovely. But I've also spoken about my struggles online, because again, I know not everyone has that experience, and a lot of the people that watch me are also from maybe like African households where it's not so spoken about. So I think it's been helpful for me to like open up and be like, I go through this and it is actually normal. It's not like something you can't talk about, and it's gone quite well.
Thinking about who you might talk to about these kind of things, it can be really important to think, who will I first feel comfortable with? Who do I trust with this? Because it can be quite, put you in a vulnerable position when you open up to someone. And whether that's, you know, an adult in your life, it could be a parent or carer or teacher or a doctor or anyone. But it can be a good idea to kind of plan and prepare that conversation as well. On our channel, we've done videos on all sorts of things like anxiety, depression, and I think one of the reactions that we get quite often is that young people really find it hard to express how they feel in words. It can be really hard to put how you're feeling into words. So I think, you know, the more that we're talking about it, the more we're speaking up, it can just help others to relate to that and say, okay, that's what I'm feeling right now. And this is why I need to get help as well.
I started doing this thing because I get quite anxious randomly. Like, I'll just wake up and have like such an anxious day. And basically what I'll do is write a list of what's worrying me and then write resolutions for it, because there's usually a resolution for it. And if there's not, then I just tell myself, like, then why are you worrying about it? Because it's not something you can actually fix. So yeah, that's something I get quite a lot, because I, like, sometimes you get anxious and you're like, I don't know why I'm anxious. So I just write down the most random things that could possibly add to it, even if it's like the smallest thing, like, oh, I ran out of toothpaste, like, just write it down so then you can have a resolution, like, buy more toothpaste. So yeah, that really does help me cope a little bit, just to sort of see it on paper and see it's not as bad as my brain is making it out to be.
I kind of try and break down all the little things that I haven't done that would be good for me if I just got them done, and then sort of in the process of that, I've sort of managed to distract myself a little bit. The other thing, like writing a to-do list, or in my case, I write post-it notes and move them around my board, because I find it's helpful to have them in visual. And then the other thing I've done, which might be a bit weird, I don't know, is I started doing meditation about a year ago.
That is not weird at all.
It feels weird.
When you're doing it, it feels weird.
Well, no, it feels weird to talk about it. Because it's like, imagine me just there like, doing nothing. It's weird because you're doing nothing, literally doing nothing. And that's really helped. Like, on days, like, often I will go, like, because obviously I'm also going down traditional mental health services and routes, but often I'll meditate and then I'll suddenly realize, like, oh my, that day was a little bit easier. The other thing I do, which is sort of another form of meditation, really, is I go out and I eat my breakfast in the garden and I watch bees. And that seems another thing. It seems weird. I don't know if you've ever watched a bee. They're really interesting. And I think so much of the time, so much of at least my feelings are to do with not feeling like I have a connection to anything, or feeling disconnected from the world in general, or feeling like people are disappointing or that I'm disappointing. And actually, in the same way that like a dog is, it loves you unconditionally, I think it so helps me to like watch a bee, and like, because I feel like suddenly I have a connection to the world as a greater part, like I feel like part of a greater system. That, again, that sort of stems from meditation, I guess. Yeah, it really helps me. It's hard to get into, and I wouldn't recommend going off and paying loads of money to something like Headspace, because they're just taking your money. But there's an app called Insight Timer that's free, and that helps me a lot, and it guides you through it.
And to be honest, there's also like meditation stuff on YouTube anyway.
Sure, yeah, exactly.
I find that like touching leaves and stuff, going outside for a walk and just like connecting yourself to everything outside can be really good. I love running, anything physical, but we say that there's like anything physical that you can do and try. It could be walking. You could try something new that can be really scary, but that feeling of accomplishment, like me on this sofa right now, can be like a good thing to do as well.
You're
you push the
great.
Boat out, thank you, and you get that feeling afterwards. I did it. I didn't think I was going to be able to, but I did it. Or you could, do it, try it, and share it. So the last thing is like just go and hang out with your friends, and like you said, that connection to other people, you remember who you are and like you know, where your place in your friendship as well. It can be really useful.
When you do meditate or look at bees or stroke leaves, etc., for a long time it's going to feel stupid. And, like, it doesn't work instantly, and it's not. It's going to be hard, and it takes effort, and you have to work at it, and you'll feel dumb for a long time. But I promise it does help.
The other thing I agree with that, but the other thing with meditation, we'll try and not make this all about meditation, but you have to not be hard on yourself as well. Like, if you miss, like, say, try and do it every day or every few days, but if you miss a day or two, it's not, like, it's not about that.
Really?
It's about finding some peace in your mind, so...
Because as well, like, think about the last time you did actually nothing. Like, imagine you're a computer, which in some ways you are. When's the last time you just shut yourself down? Like, because you're watching a TV show, you're analysing plot and watching lights and things. Like, actually think about the last time you went, other than sleep. Sleep doesn't count because you're not conscious, so that's...
I think it's a personal thing as well. So someone might find that yoga helps for them, someone might find that running helps for them, but it's so individual. And you're saying don't be hard on yourself, it's so true. And if something doesn't work, try something else.
My name is Dodi, hello. I am a musician. I also kind of vlog a lot and talk about my brain. I have derealization, which, if you don't know what that is, it's basically dissociation. It's just when your brain kind of takes a step back from the world, always. It's not fun. It just makes you very spaced out, and it's caused me depression, like severe depression, anxiety. Thankfully, I'm not depressed at the moment, which is very nice. But yeah, I've talked about my mental health online, sometimes when I have been depressed, sometimes when I haven't, and recently I'm kind of taking a step back from exploring that online because I think it's healthier for me.
I was about to move on to stigma and negative feedback and how you deal with that. Have you experienced it? To what level? And then how did you deal with that?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. It's difficult. Yeah, there are a lot of, like, gossip sites and also in the comments and, like, just, like, in the community of online and YouTube. People have, like, accused me and other people of, like, romanticizing mental health. And I think that is difficult because, honestly, to a point, I did, but for my benefit, I thought it was helpful. So the way I helped myself through bad episodes is to kind of, like, treat it as something... kind of like special about yourself. I was like, oh, this helps me write. I'm a more empathetic person with this. And that's only because if I didn't do that, I would go full-blown mad. So I was like, you know what, I'm going to try and use what I can with this. And me kind of putting out that message kind of made it look like I was like, depression is magical. So everyone was like, this is a bit problematic. So it's tough. I don't think there's a right answer. But at the moment, I'm like, yeah, taking a step back to kind of figure out what to do with it.
Everyone's nice to me.
All right. So, well.
But no, I just mean, like, Dodie's obviously spoken much more extensively than I have. I've only done sort of two or three, max three, four things about my state. But I often put out, like, sad little tweets about life's a mess or, like, existence is futile. But I've never really had what you've had, which is sort of the accusation of... romanticizing. I suppose because I don't really incorporate it into what I make in the same way you do.
Everyone's not really well. I feel like a lot of people have mental health problems. So when you see something online that's like, haha, life is pointless, everyone's like, retweet. So it can just kind of seem like a funny, you know, quirk when really it is cry for help. I think I've seen a TED talk on this.
So you think some of that stuff maybe is also... fueling that stigma? Like, at the same time, we need to get rid of the stigma and break down those walls and feel comfortable to talk about it, but then that kind of mentality can fuel some stigma.
I don't know, it's tough. It's like there's just so many different people with so many different principles. Everyone's like, talk about it and be honest and open, break down the stigma, and some people are like, shut up about it. You're like giving it too much attention. So I don't really know. I think you just kind of have to stick to what you think is right.
I think it's about sharing where you feel like you're going to get support as well. So, you know, if you're getting responses like, that give you support and comfort you in those moments. That can be really a good thing to do. But if you're not getting that reaction and, you know, you've put something out there that makes you feel quite vulnerable, it can be quite damaging as well. So it's about sharing it in spaces where you feel comfortable, sharing with maybe people face to face as well, if that feels like online isn't working. But, you know, loads of people find that online helps, so it's up to the individual.
What are the top 2-3 things that you think is important when you're going to support a friend who's struggling with a mental health problem?
I think just listening. And I don't think when you are listening, don't feel like you need to fix them. Because I think that's what happens quite a lot. And I noticed I was actually doing this with my sister when she'd tell me, like, oh, I'm struggling with this or that. Like, I try and be like, I want to fix it because I don't like seeing her upset and it upsets me. So I'm like, I want to make you feel better. But it's just that letting them be in that space and it's like letting them know it's okay not to be okay and not trying to be like, you need to be happy now and you need to get better. And just, I think that's really important, just to let them like let it all out and just be what they are at that moment. So yeah,
you're so right, that is such a good point. It's so tempting to be like, okay, well, we can do this and this and this, and sometimes there is no solution. The solution is to just feel like a mess for a while and lie on your floor. So let them do that. Yeah.
When you're in one of these places, one thing you can do is to try and fix things you can fix.
Yeah.
Like, for example, I've run out of toothpaste, I'll go get some toothpaste.
Right.
That seems trivial, but try and focus on stuff you can actually fix. And one thing I had once, I have a friend called Rachel Kiki, who people on Twitter sometimes know, where she did something for me, which may not be for everyone, but it really helped me, where I was having a really horrible time, and she basically went, I'm coming over, you don't have any choice, I'm going to come around, I'm going to tidy your room, I'm going to buy you things, I'm going to buy you food if you need food, I'll make you something, I'll help you plan out a video if you need to make a video, and really just kind of taking control. And it was basically doing the part of what you said about buying toothpaste for me, but basically doing that bit for me because I couldn't really do it. And she knew that I, in my specific circumstance, may get through it. Now, that might not be for everyone. Maybe you don't like being sort of babied. And you have to sort of tailor it to the person. But that really helped me, where just a friend goes, like, I get what you're going through, and I'm going to help do anything I can. I know I can't fix you, but I'll fix your surroundings.
What she did as well was let you know that you're not a burden. I think that's such a heavy symptom of like all mental health. It's like, as soon as I feel depression, I'm like, I'm going to shut up about it and not say anything because it's just annoying. It's so annoying that I talk about it all the time. Whereas when I'm sad, I'm like, guys, I'm sad, I need to cry. With depression, I'm always just like shut down. So I think if your friend, if you know your friend is struggling, check in, because it shows that you care. Because I know like you do care and you want to see how they're doing. But be like, you're not a burden to me. I want to know how you're doing. And I'm here as a space to listen.
It can help if you're, you know, if you don't know where to start with something, you could maybe talk about something in the news or on a TV episode that you've seen that kind of relates to that, or a YouTube video that you've seen, and bring it up in a kind of, you know, third party way. Did you see that thing about that? And test someone's reaction. But it can also really help to just prepare what exactly you want to say, how you will feel once you've said that, and what you think you want from that conversation as well, and that can help you. But it could just be, you know, something as simple as, I've got something to tell you, or I want to tell you something, and just making sure you do that privately, or and when thinking about, you know, a space where you've got time to do that as well.
I always say I'm not feeling very well recently, and then that kind of makes it like a physical thing, especially if they don't really understand like mental health issues, if, you know, they're like, just go outside, go for a run, which I get a lot of online. Just be like, I'm not feeling very well and I want to talk to you about it.
In instances where maybe a professional is needed, firstly, one, have any of you had experiences with doctors and GPs on your issues, and what was that like? And then two, how do you seek that help? How do you go about it? Especially because it's quite scary to go to a doctor and talk about these things, because they're not somebody you know, well, unless they're your family doctor, they're not someone you know. No.
I called Childline when I was 16, only once, but it was really good. Anyway, so I've gone through NHS and through medication and through therapy, and I had 12 weeks of therapy on the NHS, which wasn't long enough. There's more to this coil to unravel. And I haven't been able to get private yet. I want to, and I'm trying to save up money, but it's so expensive. But it was really good, and it's great having somebody to talk to and great having somebody to sort of just, I don't know if you've ever had therapy, but they sort of just stare at you and wait for you to work.
Oh my God,
and it's horrible. They just go, you say something that reveals something about you, and then they go, what does that mean? And it's
why are they from like Cockney? Like, what does that mean?
You don't know the therapist I had, Dodie. He was from South London. All right, Luke, why are you sad?
Anyway, that sounds quite scary, though. Yeah. How do you like?
It's not like
so,
that.
Therapy for me was great, but not long enough. I think it has to be an ongoing thing. But a fantastic experience all round. Can be uncomfortable. I think there's a sort of, my idea of going into it was that therapy had to be good. Therapy was actually quite, not nice. Not like bad, but it doesn't have to be nice. You're basically having to go through your brain, finding out everything that's wrong with you, and relive it.
Yeah. You really just have to be completely honest and vulnerable and know that they've heard it all. Like, humans are humans.
I guess you have to remind yourself, and it might be scary in that moment, that you're here to help yourself.
Yeah.
Like, you're trying to help yourself, and that's why you're there. And, okay, there's a stranger looking at you, but what you said, yeah.
Like you said, Tio, they've heard everything. You can say anything. Dodie said and it's going to... It's other than the hour you spend in their room per week, it's not going to affect their life or your life.
Yeah.
And that's a really hard thing to get over. I never personally found it awkward. I was quite... quickly just like, bleh, this is me.
If you're struggling to figure out what to say, when you're in your bad moments, write it down, like write out a list of the things you're feeling. Oh, here's a good one. There's a feelings page. My friend Hazel goes to therapy as well. She showed me there's like a page of all these different words. And sometimes I'll come to her and I'll be like, Hazel, I'm sad and I'm crying. And she's like, do you feel sad? Or do you feel all of these things? Point them out. And she'll hand it to me and I'll be like, I feel frustrated. I feel guilty. I feel... hopeless, I feel blah, blah, blah. And then it can kind of like, yeah, and then you can write all those things down and bring it to your therapist. Another way is to talk about your dreams. That's what I do. And then they're like, and how did that make you feel? And then you'll talk about it and eventually just like leeway into something. Just start talking about anything. Talk about your week and it'll eventually lead down to your schemas.
I want to keep like, from an awkward science, your brain basically goes, scan, what can I say? And then the first thing you say, or one of the things you say, reveals something. Or it did with me, at least. That helped. Even if you did that, you could do that to yourself, almost. You could sit in silence in the mirror, look at yourself, and go, I am not a professional.
Are you okay?
How has talking about it, your problems, the things that you're going through on YouTube, how have it helped your understanding of mental health? And has it had any impact on your mental health, positive or negative?
One thing I like just realized, like one thing I started doing was just, if I am having a bad mental health day, instead of just being like, you know, I feel whatever, I'm just like, I'm ill. Because it's the same thing. And it's like, once you realize that it's like, it's not like a cold, but it's like when you get a cold, you're ill and you treat yourself a certain way and you're like, you know, I need to look after myself. And I think it's just the same thing. And I think it's been really helpful for me to see so many people going through it as well, because then I'm like, everyone else has been ill too. Like everybody gets a cold. Everybody can also have mental health issues. And I think that's really been so good for me, opening up online and seeing other people like talking about it, because then I'm like, this is so normal, and the only thing that makes you feel weird about it is that when people don't really talk about it every day, but the fact that it's so open now, I think it's been really positive. And I think the only negative thing about it is that if everyone's just like, everything sucks, then everybody feels that, because sometimes when you see somebody else going through something, it triggers you a little bit, like trigger warning. I think that's the only thing that can be tough. So I think, it can be.
But also cool. That means you've got empathy, haven't you? Yeah. Sounds
good. It's a really, really weird thing to have as well as mental health issues. Like, mental health issues are hard enough, but with like the whole f***ing, like millions of people watching you as well, that is obviously going to affect it in a terrible way sometimes. So like, I think it is also incredibly positive and amazing. I've learned so much about myself and felt so much less alone. And like to be able to create and share as well online, that's helped me magnificently. But also, there's loads of little voices that sound like the voices in your head, but they're real and they're people and they're talking about you. So I feel like I've developed like anxiety and social anxiety because of online things as well. It's just like a lot at once, and it's great and it's bad and it's great. A lot of me used to want to just tell everyone everything all the time, but if you treat online like a diary, then it's kind of tough. I think keep those things, keep those personal things for yourself and for your private life. And then I think a good way to do it is like write it down and write everything that you're feeling and then come back to it in a good place. Like don't share in the moment, I think. Maybe like sit on your things for a while, maybe show it to a few of your friends and see what they think about it being online. And then if you feel good about it after sitting on it for a long time, then maybe share.
From Childline's side, we see like there's so many videos out there. I've learned so much about mental health and how to cope with different mental health issues and kind of doing things that come into meditation, like breathing, just taking a moment to yourself, grounding yourself when you're feeling really like things are really tough can be a really good thing. I think also in terms of the stigma, boys talking about mental health has increased because of social media, and I think that's a great thing. We are seeing more boys coming forward and talking about how they feel. And over on the Childline stand, we just asked what helps when people feel stressed, and we've got a whole wall of different ideas now, and it's just amazing that, you know, you see everyone has their own ideas and you can learn so much from them as well.
I just want to help people feel less alone. That's it, really. It's not even, when I post online, it's nothing to do with me. It's not me going, like, I need this. It's more, other than if I'm, like, sad and I'm like, blah, 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 everything's rubbish. But when I post about something, like, an actual thought-through thing about mental health, it's always, like, I have a platform, I have some kind of weird responsibility, and even if I don't have a responsibility, I can help and could help, and why wouldn't I? That seems silly. Yeah.
I don't know. I think because I feel this way and then I see other people being like, I have this thing. I'm like, I can help. I've learned some things. Let me help. But I've definitely shared in that unhealthy way as well of being like, I feel alone. So I'm just going to talk into a void and blah, blah, blah. But yeah.
It's been really helpful for me just because I talk about health and fitness on my channel. And for the longest time, I never spoke about mental health, which is crazy because that's one of the biggest part of health and fitness. So I think it's been just really good from like that standpoint, being able to be like, exercise, but also look after your brain. So, yeah.